It's a great pleasure to come back to India. I've been here last year and the year before last, but in Mumbai in 2010. So it's now 5 years, oh sorry, 4 years. And I'm happy to see the city again, and all of you. So I was asked to talk about our research, and I will do this. So assuming that all of you are either students or graduates, or I will not explain much, just a little bit about fundamentals. So first, what interested me as a young scientist, and I think it still is interesting to me and probably to many more, is how proteins are being made, how they are produced, and to which extent we can look into these reactions. So just to remind you, proteins are performing almost every function in every living cell. What you see here in the slide are mammalians, human, and I highlighted some of the functions of ribosomes in human, but ribosomes work also in bacteria, in flowers, in fish, in elephant, in every organism that has cells, within the cells. So here you can see that proteins allow us our sensory functions. They transport, for instance, this truck is symbolizing hemoglobin, taking oxygen from the lungs to the muscles. Muscles themselves are proteins. There are proteins that are functioning as regulators, like insulin that regulates the level of sugar in the blood, and there are structural proteins. So if to look at it in words, they are performing almost all cellular functions, not all, but almost all. Those required for smooth life, and I talked about everything. I didn't mention digestion. They digest the food that we are eating and use its component to make other cell components. Muscle motion, breathing, immune response. This is already belonging to responses to pressures like heat, cold shocks, organ failures. Like sometimes people can take care of their own heart problem. There are two proteins for that. And for instance, cleaning dust in the eye when there is a fear that the dust has some bacteria in it. So there are proteins that can chop the membrane of the bacteria that come maybe with the dust, and the tear is taking care of cleaning it. So in nature, I hope you can see, in nature there is a rule. Structure means function, or function means structure. And for those that are not structure-oriented, I brought a very simple example. I think that you all know what are these paper clips, and they can collect together and keep together a few pages. With my own fingers, I distorted their structure and got all these figures, just with my fingers. I didn't boil, I didn't heat, I didn't put acid, I didn't cut, I didn't do anything. Just change the structure, the fold. Now, the fold is not correct, and it cannot do the duty or the task that these particular pieces of metal could do when they had the correct fold. This is the basics. This is basics for protein function. Proteins are long chains made of amino acids. I hope that all of you know that. There are 20 types of amino acids. And the fold of each protein, which is carefully designed for fulfilling its function, is determined by the sequence of the amino acids that are building it. So on these chains, the 20 types can be ordered in different ways, and the result are different folds. Normal protein is about 150 to 500 amino acids, and they are built of these 20 types. The sequence of the amino acid that are within any protein dictates the protein structure, thus enabling their function. I said it already, but what determines the sequence? The sequence of the protein is determined by the gene that codes for it. So each protein has its own gene, and each gene has its own protein. And some genes are common to the same organism, some are different. So the genes that code for the proteins that allow our muscle function are the same, or things like that. The genes that code for the color of our hair can be different, but they are not the main genes. The DNA that has the genes in it is a string of instructions. It has no duty when it is just sitting there. The instructions have to be read, and the cell has to function accordingly. The instructions are reading in a four-letter language. Just all DNAs, all nucleic acids have four bases, four letters. Can you imagine? I am until now excited about the fact that all life can be described in a four-letter language. Just incredible, but it is. Each three letters of the four are coding for a specific amino acid. Or each amino acid is coded by a triplet of letters, which are called also bases or nucleotides of the DNA. So the translation of the genetic code to proteins means reading a four-letter language and functioning in a 20-letter language. And I wanted to understand how this is done. I just want to show you a structure of a protein. I hope that all of you have seen something like this. Proteins are made of many atoms. Each ball here represents an atom. The atoms that are frequently or almost always composing proteins are carbon, oxygen, nitrogen, and sulfur. Each of them has a color. Please pay attention to this point here. It is a cavity, and this is where this protein is active, its active site. So if we look at it, I enlarged it and rotated it together with the substrate, the khaki purple. Now you can see that the active site is made exactly to accommodate this substrate, and the substrate is perfectly accommodated within the active site. This protein is chopping, it cuts here, and you can imagine if the substrate was too large, it won't fit, and too small, it will be floppy, and the cutting will not be done or will be done wrongly. So the structure is very important. Not only very important, is the key for functioning. Oops, sorry. So there are 20 types of amino acid. All amino acids have the same backbone, but various side chains. So I symbolized five amino acids out of the 20, They all have the same backbone, like this puzzle. I colored it in different colors for explaining, but actually all the backbones are the same. And the side chains are different. So the side chains give the chemical property. Some side chains acquire hydrophobicity, hydrophilicity. It means they like water, they hate water, they like themselves. And some are tools, biological, biochemical tools. They come together, they make chains. And here I didn't draw all the side chains, just the tools. And they make even longer chains. And here I didn't draw anything, just showed you how some points on it to show how long it is. And this has no meaning unless it is correctly folded and has an active site. That's the story of what is a protein. It was known when I started, it was known that proteins are made of amino acids, that amino acids come together according to the genes and grow until they reach their full size and then they fold. But it was not known how it happens, especially not how the amino acids come together to make a chain, which is this arrow here. So this is what I wanted to explore, to understand. And there was a over the world skepticism about the possibility to do it. I myself was not sure, but I knew that if we get there, if we really understand it, we will have a smiley, and we do. The genes are part of the DNA. We talked about it. I hope that you all know that DNA is a double helical molecule, and the instructions, the bases are within the double helix. There are four of them, and they make two types of pairs, and they are here. So all the information is here, but in here it is not available because it is masked by the backbone. So therefore, it first has to be transcripted to a similar molecule called RNA, and in this particular case, messenger RNA, which has the property to stay as a single helix or single molecule, single chain, and therefore the instructions can be read here. So this is a copy of that. It's almost the same molecule. The backbone is different because it has to stay as a single chain. Three out of the four bases are exactly the same in both, and one is slightly different. So actually, this is a copy of the DNA, and in life, the connections between the bases here in the DNA are like DNA to RNA, RNA to RNA, and RNA to DNA. It really doesn't matter what it is. The RNA, the message that is here, is being translated to proteins. Here you can see a piece of a protein growing chain, and this happens by the ribosome. So this is what I wanted to understand, how the ribosome does its job. How does it work? So we like to describe the ribosome as a factory, universal factory that exists in all living cells in large numbers, that produces proteins according to the code, the genetic code, by decoding it. So here is the code coming in linearly into our little factory. Each triplet here is coding for a specific amino acid. The amino acids are being brought by these trucks. The trucks are very similar to each other, but slightly different in the position that the decoding happens, and also a little bit in their structure. And each of them has a cognate amino acid that it carries. These are the colorful here. So this truck will come into the factory, and this amino acid will be connected to the growing protein that grows here. Of course, this connection is happening inside the factory. I just didn't know how to draw, so I drew it out. And the genetic code, once this will go in, the code will progress in a triplet. That's the whole story. However, as I said, we didn't know. So I already mentioned that ribosomes are universal. They function in a very similar way in all cells, regardless of the source, in bacteria and in elephants. If not almost the same, very similar the same, maybe exactly the same. There is a huge number of ribosomes that function in every living cell, although they are large complexes. Mammalian cells can host, may contain up to 5-6 million ribosomes that work all the time together, like in liver cells. And even in bacteria, 80,000 to 100,000 are present while the bacteria grows. They act continuously. They can form 5 to 40 peptide bonds in 1 second. Peptide bonds are the bonds that connect the amino acid to the newly grown protein, and they can make so many in 1 second. It means a protein is being formed within a few seconds. If you allow me to tell you about my own experience, when I was a student, I was asked to make one single peptide bond. I was a fast student and a good student, but it took me 6 hours. One bond, and the ribosome makes up to 40 in 1 second. Also hardly makes mistakes, 1 to 1 million. Actually, it may make more mistakes, but it has a proofreading machinery, and it can get rid of its mistakes by its own. We can't even, as human beings, we can't even see them. Ribosomes, all ribosomes, no matter where they come from, in bacteria and in human, they're made of two subunits, a small one and a large one. The small has the ability to associate the messenger RNA, it means the code. It also provides the decoding sites, and it has the proofreading. So this is the clever part. And the large one is where the bond is being made. It also has a tunnel for which the protein goes out. These are the hands of the ribosome. When the trucks come in, there are 3 sites for them, 1, 2, and 3. Here is where the peptide bond is being made between A and P. A is amino acylated, P is peptidyl transferase, tRNA, and E is the exiting. So tRNAs, to remind you, are the trucks. So we made a movie 12 years ago that incorporates all known structures at that time and shows the ribosome from bacteria, bacterial ribosomes. I made it together with 2 students of the Art Academy in Jerusalem. And the movie is available on YouTube. And although 12 years passed, nobody complained, so probably is correct. You will see motions in the movie, and you know that I'm a crystallographer, and crystallography gives static pictures. But when I could collect together and interpolate between different structures, each of them captured at a different functional state, I could see the motions that are involved, and indeed they are. So here, messenger RNA is reaching the small subunit, the small ribosomal subunit, that takes it. You see here? Book, it took it. There are factors in the cell that allow, that tell the ribosome start and allow the function if everything is fine. So this is initiation factor number 3. There are 3 of them in bacteria, many more in human. So it sits here, make sure that the messenger is correctly bound and the first tRNA is correctly bound, and then it can go. And when it leaves, the large subunit can associate. So here it is. Messenger is now wrapped around. The first tRNA is being brought by initiation factor number 2. Now the two initiation factors live, and you can see the tRNA has an amino acid that it carries. In this movie, all the amino acids are blue because of technical reasons, but then the protein will be blue, and the large subunit comes and can associate and make bridges by conformational changes. Now we have an active ribosome, and we look at it from the outside, from the solvent side. You see tRNAs are being brought in by elongation factors, in and go out, and the ribosome helps. In, out. We took away now the large subunit so that you can see how the peptide bond is being made. We left only the tRNA and the tunnel. So meanwhile, while peptide bond is being made here, messenger is moving in triplets, and protein is growing. Now you see the whole ribosome again. Here is the internal tunnel, and the protein comes out when it's long enough. The tRNAs I brought by elongation factors and go out empty. It all goes on until there is a stop codon, and when there is a stop codon, the tRNAs are replaced by factors, recycling factor, release factor, that comes in, dissociates the two subunits, releases the protein, you see it here, that folds, and let the tRNA go out, the tRNAs go out to look for a new job. That's the whole story. What you didn't see in the movie is that many ribosomes are reading the same messenger RNA, I showed only one, and you didn't see the detail. So we know now the position of each of the atoms from which the ribosome is made, 250,000 atoms. What you see rotating is the small subunit. It's made of many components, ribosomal RNA, the gray, and ribosomal proteins, each of them in a different color. Sediments is 30S. It has a molecular weight of 0.85 megatalton. RNA has 600 bases, nucleotides, and 20 or 21 different proteins, each protein in a different color. You can also see the large subunit that rotates here. Again, it's made of a lot of RNA, two chains, 3,000 nucleotides, and up to 34 proteins. 1.5 megadalton is its weight. When we look at the part of the surface of the both subunits, when they associate with each other to make a protein, we see that all the functional sites are just gray. It means just made just of RNA. tRNA is the molecule that combines between them. Here the decoding is being made. Here the peptide bond is being made. These are the free sites. All gray, no protein. It means that the ribosome is actually an RNA enzyme, a ribozyme. And when I ask young children, what does it mean? That everything is made, or almost everything is made by proteins, and the ribosome is using its RNA. The children say that the cells don't trust the proteins to make themselves. So it sounds a little funny, but I think it's correct. I think that this is a very sophisticated regulation machinery. There are two authorities. One is the proteins, and one is the authority that makes the proteins, the RNA. This is also in agreement with the way that the ribosomes are made, mainly RNA, only a third of them is proteins. And it is also in agreement with the idea that before life, there was a different environment that was dominated by RNA. So the molecular machines before life were RNA machines. Today, we have also proteins and DNA, but at that time, there were not. So we looked into the ribosome structure, ribosomes structures, and we identified a region that is fully conserved in all known ribosome structures, and you can see here, eubacteria, archaea, eukaryotes, mitochondria. This part is exactly the same. Here you have, you can see all known structures with references here, and they're exactly the same. I cannot distinguish between them. And they actually represent the blue, where the A tRNA is, the part of A tRNA that is involved in peptide bond formation. It's always CCA, cytosine, cytosine, adenine, for those that know the names, and the P. And peptide bond will be made here. And that's the way you can see it in the ribosome. This is fully conserved. So the high conservation of the symmetrical region, and it's symmetrical. You can see it's symmetrical because it hosts the same part of tRNA. The high conservation of the symmetrical region indicates that its existence is beyond environmental conditions. If so, we call this region the proto-ribosome. We think that this is how the ribosome was made, and probably, most probably, how life started. This is the position where we can identify as origin of life. So what do I say? I say that the prebiotic chemical bonding entity is still functioning in all contemporary ribosomes, namely in all living cells. In all of us, we still, our ribosomes still have a region, a small region, that came from, to us, from the before life world. So I want to show you the size of it. You see the large subunit rotating? This is the size. This is what we talk about. It accommodates the two tRNAs. Here, peptide bond is being made, and it has this shape. I showed you earlier the shape from top, and this is the pocket-like shape that they can have together with what is their substrates today. So this is actually what we see. Peptide bond formation happens here. So let's talk a little about the shape, the pocket. This is the way we think it looks. This is where it sits in the ribosome, if we look only at that. And you can see peptide bond will be made here. And I talked to several chemists, well-known chemists, and asked them if they think that the machine or molecule like this, an entity like this, could be an enzyme, an RNA enzyme. And they say that the size and the shape support this idea. So in the ribosome, in the modern ribosome, this is the region. And it is connected chemically to the two hands that are moving. You remember in the video that I showed, the ribosome? These are the two hands. And also through the tRNA with the position where messenger RNA is being decoded. And therefore we think that it is, this is what we call the proto-ribosome, is functioning as a signaling or signal transmission center. And when we think about it twice, it makes a lot of sense, because messenger RNA should move here when a peptide bond is being made here. And this is much too far for normal signaling. And in support, let me tell you the distances from here to here, 70 angstrom, from here to here, 200 angstroms. It's much more than normal chemistry can control. So it has to be much more, and probably is provided by this region. In support of what I told you, a protein was removed from here, knocked out from here, and structural differences were detected on the other side of it. So this is the region that we think functioned before life, before cells, before genetic code, before everything. How was it made? One of our hypotheses suggests that the catalytic proto-ribosome is a product of dimerization, and it requires the existence of self-replicating, self-folding, and self-dimerizing RNA molecules. Like this, there were RNA molecules, they came together, made a pocket, could make the bonds, and recently, several well-known laboratories agree with us. So I can't tell you all the experiments we do in order to prove it. It's not the time and the place, but I can tell you some ideas we got about the emergence of the genetic code. It's just possible, it's ideas. So if a dipeptide was made, the first one could be the substrate for elongation of it, namely for the formation of oligopeptides, small proteins. And there were many of them, all made accidentally, but the existence of well-performing oligopeptides that can catalyze functional reactions or stabilize the apparatus that produced them may have led to the emergence of the genetic code. What do I mean? I want to show, first of all, a hypothetical non-coded enzyme that can help the metabolism of RNA, and therefore probably was the RNA world wanted to keep it. So here there is a small protein, small oligopeptide, that has four histidines. Actually, three are enough, and it can transport metals. I also want to show what do I mean by stabilizing the machine making them. So if this is actually the machine as we see it today, there are here several positions that can be stabilized so it will be more robust in these positions. And indeed, this idea is supported by the structure today. This is the region within the modern ribosome, and there are here proteins, one from this side and one from that side, that stabilize it. So the sum of the above implies that the genetic code co-evolved together with the ribosome as well as with its products, the proteins. And we think that this is how genetic code came into life, or life started with producing genetic codes and improving the machine that makes proteins, the ribosomes. So the evolution happened to the three of them together. So I didn't say earlier, but RNA enzymes are known to be inefficient. Ribozymes are called, and they're known to be inefficient. They are called lousy or lazy. But the ribosome is amazingly efficient. How does this happen? By the addition of the proteins into the RNA of the ribosome. So here you can see all the proteins, all the bacterial ribosomal proteins, the small subunit proteins and the large. The jobs are made by the RNA, but the proteins are really very helpful, sometimes not replaceable. Let's look at these four proteins, how they sit within the structure of the small subunit, which you see here. So the RNA fold is shown here, and you can see that these four proteins are sitting in a way that their globular part is on the surface, and they have very long extensions or loops, very long loops, that drill into the RNA structure and probably stabilize it. So this is a small subunit, and decoding will happen here. And it was found no protein is needed for decoding, but mutations here or here can lead to mistakes. Decoding will happen with mistakes because the active site here will not have the correct structure. So a summary, ribosomes architecture hint at its origin, and within the complex ribosome structure, we identify the highly conserved semi-symmetric region around the ribosome active site that can be a remnant of a prebiotic bonding apparatus called by us the proto-ribosome. I just want to highlight this region is between 3 to 4% of the total ribosomal RNA, depending on the source. So it's 3% of the human ribosome and 4% of the bacterial one. And it is still functioning in the contemporary ribosomes. So let's talk a little bit about completely different aspect of ribosomes, and this is antibiotics. Because of the fundamental role played by the ribosomes, many antibiotics target them. Actually, almost half of the useful antibiotics target the ribosome, or paralyze the ribosome, so that the next generation of the bacteria, the disease-causing bacteria or pathogens, will disappear. So what are the antibiotics? The natural antibiotics are the weapons that bacteria from one type use for interfering with the life of different species of microorganisms. It means these are the bullets, the bombs, that are functioning in bacteria life. Question is, how do the tiny antibiotics paralyze the giant ribosome? So ribosome, bacterial ribosomes, have a molecular weight of 2.5 megadalton, and antibiotics less than 1,000, between 500 to 1,000. And how can these tiny compounds paralyze the giant ribosome? Please remember, the ribosome works as an assembly line, as a factory. It's enough to stop one step in order to stop the function of the factory. So just to remind you, these are the two structures, and where are the antibiotics bound? At the active site, either where the decoding happens or where the peptide bond is being made. Let me show it in more detail. So what you see here are the skeletons of the two subunits. On the left, the large subunit, and on the right, the small subunit. And each of these balls is representing the position, the binding position of a family of antibiotics that target ribosomes. So if you look at it carefully, they all bind to active places, important places, the decoding, the bonding, the tunneling, and the hinging. If you remember, there were motions, the hinging of the motions. So I want to show you one of them, the one that we started with, in the late 50s of last century. Just after penicillin, erythromycin came into the game, and erythromycin blocks the tunnel. So what you see here is the whole large subunit. We're looking into the tunnel, and erythromycin blocks 2/3 of it. It means proteins will not be able to go out. Now there are problems. One problem is that all antibiotics bind to functional sites. But the functional sites are highly conserved because all ribosomes work more or less the same way, or maybe exactly the same way. And mandatory for clinical use is the distinction between the patient and the pathogen and the bacteria that cause diseases. This is really important. We don't want to kill the patient. And if antibiotics will paralyze the patient's ribosomes, the patient will suffer or maybe even die. So there is a problem. How is it done? And even in the highly conserved regions, there are sometimes subtle differences. And I want to show you an example. So we symbolize the tunnel to this long arrow, and we cut it perpendicular to the long axis. So you see here the tunnel walls in gray. All the tunnel walls are made of RNA in this particular place, in where erythromycin and its daughters and granddaughters bind. You see this is the tunnel, and each of the colorful things here, each of the structures is a structure of an antibiotic, a specific antibiotic that blocked the tunnel. All of them related to erythromycin. You can see that all of them block the tunnel very well or excellent or very good, but all block, and all interact with one of the tunnel components, tunnel wall components, which is adenine at position 2058. It's adenine in all eubacteria, and all pathogens are eubacteria. So this is the way that adenine is interacting with erythromycin in bacteria. Very high affinity, chemical affinity here. Please have a look at this point. This is where we differ from bacteria, from A to G. From the chemical point of view, is not so much, but A is happily accommodated with a high affinity, and G is too large, and there is a clash here, and erythromycin cannot bind. That's all, A and G, between bacteria and us. So before I go on, I have another movie, which is made on the first one, and shows how four antibiotics bind to the ribosome, and how these little ones can paralyze the huge ribosome. If it starts. Oh, okay. So here is one, it's called adenine, and it doesn't let messenger bind to its position, to its path. Just blocks the path. Little blockage, little bit more rigidity here, no passage. No patches, no binding. That's all. Second one is tetracycline that occupies the position of the A site tRNA here. The third one is what I described quickly before, earlier, and this is erythromycin that sits in the tunnel and doesn't let protein go. So here it sits in the tunnel, and only a very little protein can be made, 5-6 amino acids, and then it's stuck. And the last one is called clindamycin, and from, in my opinion, is the most clever one, and it binds to the bond, doesn't let the bond being made. So this shows how antibiotics, ribosomal antibiotics work. Resistance to antibiotics is one of the most severe problems in modern medicine. I think that you all know it. And in order to understand, to think about how to fight against resistance, the question was, how do the pathogen acquire resistance? So a prominent mechanism is to modify the anchors that show the subtle differences. For instance, from A to G, the antibiotics, the bacteria can make 4 or 5 generations a day, and they can change their genome completely. And they do this. Let's stop this. Can we combat resistance to antibiotics? I'm not sure. I'm not sure what it mean. I think that we can partially control resistance, maybe, hopefully. But combat completely, probably not, because bacteria want to live. Bacteria were on our world before us, they are also with us, they are clever. So they are either, the ideas are either new compounds or compounds made of two components. Each of them has many anchors, so it can be bound even if there is some resistance or some, mutation. A serious commitment is needed. So let me show you my idea about synergism. Here there is again a section cut perpendicular to the long axis of the tunnel and an antibiotic that is made of two components, one and second. Isn't it wonderful? They have many interaction points, many anchors, and each of the parts is disturbing the other from going out. So when I saw it, I was really happy. This was about 13 years ago. And as a chemist, I decided, why not to combine the two parts together? So we will not be wishing that the two of them come in, maybe they won't. So I was not so fast in doing what I wanted other chemists do and failed. And they explained that they failed because the new compound was, the two of them together was much too large and did not penetrate to the correct position. We wanted to know more about it, and we tried to see how the two components bind. So please have a look at this part of the active site and focus on this nucleotide here, which bulges into the center exactly where peptide bond will be made. So what you see here is ribosomal parts and two nucleotides. I'm talking about this one now, this one. So from top, it looks like this. Here it is, this red one. Here is where peptide bond will be made. Now compound A of the antibiotic that went into cell, it's called synercid, comes in and kicks this nucleotide out. Now this nucleotide is very important for peptide bond formation. It's part of the active site, and it's very flexible, so it can go out 180 degrees. The active site has been damaged this way. So life is very strong and kicks out compound A, bring back the nucleotide. And we have structures for all. But there is surplus of the antibiotic, comes in and kicks it out again. And then, if the second one comes, then it locks everything. It locks the first one from going out, and it locks the nucleotide from coming back. It means it's not only blocking, it's changing, it's modifying the active site. So being aware of this great potential of pairs, we decided to look for another one. One of the reasons that the first one, which is called synercid, is not so successful is that it's very expensive and rather toxic. So we looked for another one and we found a pair that is made by S. Roshi, which was first identified in Sri Lanka. So it's called lancacidin, lancamycin, or lanca-lanca. It's much smaller than synercid. It's also much weaker. So we are now trying to improve it. The two parts bind to each other, and we have some chemistry that helps us. So now it's time to end, and before I end, I want to thank those that helped me and helped us throughout our long journey. The Weizmann Institute president, Professor Michael Sella, allowed me to work on what was called in the whole world dream or fantasy. He just let me be there. Chaim Harari, who is a physicist, didn't change it, and both of them were encouraged by the Scientific Advisory Committee. So the Advisory Committee was at that time composed on Sir John Kendrew. Have you heard about him? Maybe not. He determined the first structure of protein together with Max Perutz. They determined the structure of hemoglobin and myoglobin. He got the Nobel Prize. He's not with us anymore. Chris Anfinsen, he showed that structure is needed for function and that sequence determined the structure. He got the Nobel Prize for it and he's not with us anymore. Alex Rich tried to crystallize, to determine the structure of ribosomes for many years. He had a very strong group and very good institute for this. He failed. He's still working at MIT, and he, although he failed, he was very supportive, so I really thank him twice as much. It all started with a very strong collaboration, very intensive collaboration with Max Planck in Berlin, molecular genetics. The head of the group was Professor Wittmann, who really wanted to see the structure of ribosomes. All what he wanted to do is to understand ribosomes. And he was very supportive, although the whole world was had a lot of skepticism and was not sure, and there were a lot of doubts, even I did, as I told you. He did support by providing knowledge, providing ribosomes, manpower, and was very industrious in starting a group for us in Hamburg where we could measure, where there was a synchrotron to measure. He was replaced first, he died 10 years before the structure came, and he was replaced first by Franceschi and then by Fuccini. So I had two research groups, and I want to thank all the members for their determination and devotion in very difficult, also in good times. The group in Hamburg was terminated 10 years ago, but I wanted to show you that it always had angels in it, because the technical assistant said that only angels can work on such a project. I want to tell you that when we worked, we had to clean, and sometimes we had to go really far for measurements. The group in Israel is still working, and while I'm talking to you here, it is being run by the senior scientist, Dr. Anat Bashan, that is deciding about what to do and how to do, and train the postdocs and the students. And here I want a few words to the female students, or junior or graduates. There is a say or a vision. It's not good. Women shouldn't go to science. They cannot do good science and be good housewives or good mothers or have good families. This is what the society says, directly or indirectly. In the past, it was said very strongly, now not so strongly, but still it gives the feeling that the society does not expect women to be good scientists and good housewives. Girls, it's not correct. Young girls that think about, that debate with themselves, shall I be a scientist or not? This is not correct. Anat is a fantastic scientist. Oops, she. Fantastic scientist, very, very good. And she's also a very good mother. She has three children that love her. Ella is also a very good scientist. She has only two children, but still very good home. Raz traced all the RNA in the two subunits, ribosomal subunit, within a year. He is fantastic. He also has three children. He is now a professor in another university, but we won't talk about him because he's a man. He doesn't belong to this discussion. Tamar, well, first of all, Ilana. Ilana is also something incredible scientist. She discovered the proto-ribosome. She has four children. And Tamar. Tamar came to us as a young girl 16 years ago for 10 weeks. She's still around, very long. Meanwhile, she has her own family and three children. At the day that I took this picture, wait a second. At the day that I took this picture, she had her birthday. She baked a cake. So female scientists know even to bake. You want to see her cake? You probably don't see it very well. But now you can. This is her cake. And this shows that in my group, even the ribosome is considered sweet. I also want to thank my family. You can see here my daughter, who is an MD, and my granddaughter, that was a student, a high school student. Also my mother, my sister, all my family that were always supporting me, although they had no scientific background. And I want to tell you that my granddaughter thinks the same. She said, my name is Noah Ada's granddaughter. As you know, she is a very busy scientist, but she always finds time for me. You see, it's possible, girls, it's possible. Possible to do very good science and still have a granddaughter that loves. My granddaughter gave me also a prize. So you probably invited me because of this prize, which is the Nobel Medal. No, it's enough. What my granddaughter gave me, which is for me as important, maybe even more, is this one. The grandma of the year is Ada Yonath. She was, at that time, she was 9 years old, much before the Nobel. And when I asked her, which year of the year, which year, every prize has a year. You know what she answered? You have to reprove yourself every year. And when you fail, I'll take it off the wall. And it's still on the wall. And that's the only prize I have to be reevaluated every year. So it's possible, girls, if you think about, if you hesitate about becoming scientists, see, it's possible. I also want to show you that it's still on the wall, and also that in carnivals in Israel, the ribosomes are very strong. You see, he's me, and she's a ribosome. Here, when she dances, you see the protein comes out? Also, young children become ribosomes. And this is what happened to me, which was made by an artist that never met me. And he said that my hairstyle fits ribosomes. Thank you.